is no other name but the name of Jesus. And Father, we lift our hearts to you this morning. We're expectant. We're expecting you to do great things this morning. In your mighty name. Amen. You may be seated. We're not going to break the flow of the Holy Spirit, so we'll do the notices later. Andre is going to kindly share with us this morning. Welcome, Andre. Welcome to any visitors that are here with us for the first time. Well, is anyone here for the first time? Would you raise your hand? No one here for the first time. Anyway, it's great to have you with us. Andre, thanks very much. Andre is going to be sharing on another series in our church on fire. That's on transformation. I'm going to hand over to you, Andre.
Thanks, Al. Good morning, Base Church. I'm so glad you've been able to join us for the service. And as Al said, we're continuing the series about the role and work of the Holy Spirit in the church on fire. Can we open in prayer? I don't think we can ever pray enough. But Father, thank you that we can meet together in fellowship as we worship you. Thank you for your promise that wherever two or more gather in your name, you're in our midst. Holy Spirit, soften and prepare the soil of our hearts so that the seed of the word will germinate and produce a bountiful harvest of righteousness in our lives. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, as Christians, we usually know what we should or shouldn't be doing or thinking. And when we don't, there's usually plenty of helpful believers who are willing to tell us what they think we should or shouldn't be doing. And that seems to be a huge trend and issue in politics and in society recently. I don't know if you've been following the headlines, and all sorts of people seem to believe that they are qualified to tell others what they should think and what they should believe and how they should act. And there seems to be this huge divide in society around the world. Many Christians do what they think they're supposed to do, hoping that they will no longer want to do what they're not supposed to do. And you know, it's a very real struggle that all of us face, and we're not alone in that. Paul actually writes about this internal tug of war in his letter to the Romans in chapter 7, verses 15 to 20, and he says, "For I do not understand my own actions. I'm baffled and bewildered by them. I do not practice what I want to do, but I am doing the very thing that I hate, and I'm yielding to my human nature, my worldliness, my sinful capacity. Now, if I habitually do what I do not want to do, that means that I agree with the word, with the law, confessing that it is good, that it is morally excellent. So now, if that is the case, then it is no longer I who do it, the disobedient thing that I despise, but it is the sin, the nature that lives in me. For I know that nothing good lives in me, that is in my flesh, my human nature, my worldliness, my sinful capacity. For the willingness to do good is present in me, but the doing of the good is not. For the good that I want to do, I do not do, but I practice the very evil that I do not want. But if I am doing the very thing I do not want to do, I am no longer the one doing it. That is, it is not me that acts, but it is the sin nature which lives in me." If you don't recognize that, it's the Amplified Bible. It sort of really expands on the things. You know, Charles Swindoll, wrote a book about these struggles that we face in the life of faith, and he called his book, 3 Steps Forward and 2 Steps Back. And there's a lot of reality in that, but sometimes it feels more like it's 2 Steps Forward and 3 Steps Back. But there's a big difference between this inward wrestling for righteousness and the outward compliance to standards of speech and behavior in order to appear righteous. Jesus had some pretty harsh words for people who depend on outward compliance only without making real progress towards change. In Matthew 23, he said, "Woe to you self-righteous scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites! For you're like whitewashed tombs that look beautiful on the outside, but inside are full of dead men's bones and everything unclean. So outwardly seem to be just and upright to men, but inwardly you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. A word of caution here, if I may. You know, the struggle for righteousness is largely inward, and it's usually unknowable to the outside observer. We cannot see the heart. Only God sees that. And we shouldn't judge one another based only on our observations. In his account of the gospel, Luke recorded this incident when he said, "And then Jesus told this story to some who had great confidence in their own righteousness and scorned everyone else. Two men went to the temple to pray. One was the Pharisee and the other was a despised tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer, 'I thank you, God, that I am not a sinner like everyone else, for I don't cheat, I don't sin, and I don't commit adultery. I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week, and I give you a tenth of my income.' But the tax collector stood at a distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, 'O God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner.' I tell you, this sinner and not the Pharisee returned home justified before God." We really can't judge from outward appearances. And in Matthew's gospel, Jesus warned that we will be judged with the measure that we use ourselves in judging others. That's a scary thought. Our whole world desperately needs to see and experience the mercy and grace of God demonstrated in the speech and the actions of his disciples. Changed your behavior, hoping that your heart and your desire will change as well. We avoid certain places and certain activities that, with the hope that over time our desire for those things will go away. We do something externally, hoping that it'll change something internally. This is called behavior modification, and a lot of the self-help books that are currently on the market are all about how fake it till you make it. Change it until it changes, you're changed. And it does usually result in a temporary change until either our circumstances change or we're influenced negatively, or the effort of resisting temptation by willpower alone just becomes overwhelming and exhausting. The Bible tells us that transformation is the work of the Holy Spirit. It begins when we pray with David, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right and steadfast spirit within me." It's from Psalm. I like the way that it's expressed in the Passion Translation. It says, "Keep creating in me a clean heart. Fill me with pure thoughts and holy desires ready to please you." The footnote for this verse says that the word "create" is the same word that's used in Genesis chapter 1, meaning to create it from nothing. David knew that he had no goodness without God placing it inside him. And he asked for a new creation heart, not just an old one changed. "Create in me a new heart, God." David already knew from personal experience what Jeremiah would later teach. "The heart is deceitfully wicked above all things, and it is incurable. Who can understand it fully and know its secret motives?" It's in Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 9. But through the prophet Ezekiel, God gave a promise. He said, "I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh." And it is by the regenerative, transforming power of the Holy Spirit alone so are changed and purified. Chapter 9 of Acts tells the story of a man named Saul. All of you know it. He was a Pharisee filled with religious zeal, determined to stamp out the heresy of Jesus the Messiah. He was a fierce persecutor of the followers of Jesus, hunting them down and arresting them so that they could be tried and executed until the day that he had an encounter with Jesus while traveling to Damascus. That encounter left Saul blind until a man named Ananias came to pray for him. In chapter 9 and verse 17, it says, "And so Ananias went and found Saul. He laid his hands on him, and he said, 'Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road, has sent me so that you might regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit.'" That event, the infilling of the Holy Spirit, was the beginning of a transformation in Saul. From being a persecutor, he became one of the leading apostles of the early church. The rest of his life, building what he had previously tried to destroy. His transformation was so radical that his name was changed from Saul to Paul. And he wrote almost half of the New Testament. But transformation isn't just a first century event. It still happens today. And if I can get a little bit personal, I was a wild and rebellious teenager. My father was so concerned about me that when I went to university, he was praying for me. And he wasn't even born again at the time. In my first year at university at Peter Maritzburg, I came back to my res late one night, and I stopped in my neighbor's room. He was still up studying. I'd been out drinking. And after some conversation, he challenged me about what I believed about Jesus. So I ducked and I dived a bit, and I said, I told him I would sleep on it and I'd tell him in the morning, let him know what I thought. And he got up and locked his door. And he said, "If you leave now, in the morning you'll pretend I never asked you that question. So you can choose yes or you can choose no, but before I let you out, you have to decide." Well, I argued with him for about 2.5 hours. And I asked all the tough questions, you know, like, if God is real and he's so good, why all the suffering in the world? And he was really wise. You know, he refused to debate any of those questions. And he just said, "I don't know why, and I don't have an answer. But the real issue is, are you going to serve him or not?" Well, I finally chose yes at about 1:30 in the morning. So he prayed with me. And then he said, "Now you need to be baptized." So we went and woke up the res leader, and they ran a cold bath, and they baptized me at 2:00 in the morning in September. Then the next morning, before breakfast even, the guy in the room who was over the corridor from me knocked on my door. Now, he had a big "I'm a believer" sticker on his door. And when he opened his door, I usually closed mine. And he said, "I heard you were born again last night. I need to teach you about being filled with the Holy Spirit." And he sat down on my bed, opened his Bible, and he showed me the scriptures about baptism in the Holy Spirit, and then he prayed for me to receive the Holy Spirit, and I did. Then that same week, another member from the res group introduced himself, and he said, I needed to be discipled. And so we met nearly every evening for Bible study and prayer. God really got hold of me, and he began to change me from the inside out. 9 months later, a friend who had been in my class all the way through high school stopped me on campus one morning, and he said to me, "What's changed you so much?" He says, "You're not the same guy that you were at school." God still transforms us when we let him. The thing is that that work of transformation is not a one-time event. It's an ongoing process throughout our lives. In Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6, Paul says, "I am convinced and confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will continue to perfect and complete it until the day of Christ Jesus." Our transformation begins when we're born again, and it continues throughout our lives. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18, Paul said, "And we all, with unveiled faces, continually seeing as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are progressively being transformed into his image, from one degree of glory to even more glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. This ongoing work of transformation is a two-part process. Mostly, it's the work of the Holy Spirit. Without him working in us, there can be no transformation. And we cannot change our nature by willpower and positive thinking. At the same time, we also have a part to play. The Holy Spirit does not transform us against our will. He needs our cooperation. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13, it says, "Continue to work out your salvation. That is, cultivate it, bring it to full effect, actively pursuing spiritual maturity. With awe-inspired fear and trembling, use serious caution and critical self-evaluation to avoid anything that might offend God or discredit the name of Christ." That's our part. "For it is not your strength, but it is God who is effectively at work within you, both to will and to work, that is strengthening, energizing, and creating in you the longing and the ability to fulfill your purpose for his good pleasure." God's part, the Holy Spirit working. We do our part by immersing ourselves in the Word, reading our Bibles, and by willingly submitting to the work of the Holy Spirit as he creates in us the longing and the ability to fulfill our purpose. Both actions, reading and submitting, are a conscious choice on our part. Paul wrote to the Romans, and he exhorted them in chapter 12, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies, dedicating all of yourselves set apart as a living sacrifice, holy and well-pleasing to God, which is your rational, logical worship. Do not be conformed to this world any longer with its superficial values and customs, but be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually, focusing on godly values and ethical attitudes, so that you may prove for yourselves what is the will of God, which is good and acceptable and perfect in his plan and purpose for you." That phrase, "be transformed," comes from the Greek word that we now use, meaning metamorphosis, an inward process that leads to a permanent outward change, in the same way that a caterpillar metamorphoses into a butterfly. It can't go back. Daniel Boorstin, the historian and a librarian of Congress, identified a significant cultural shift in the late 19th century when we changed from calling people who went on journeys travelers to calling them tourists. According to my Chambers 20th century dictionary, the word traveler originates from an old French word, travail. We still use that word in English. So a traveler means someone who travails, who labors, who suffers, who endures. In the olden times, if I can use that term, a traveler who went on a journey immersed themselves in the culture that they were visiting. They learned the language and the customs. They dressed and ate with the inhabitants. The traveler returned from the journey permanently changed by the experience. Tourists, completely different. My dictionary says that a tourist is one who visits a place out of curiosity, observing without commitment or involvement. Generally, a tourist sticks with the safe and the familiar. They might learn some words and phrases, but the language and the culture remain unfamiliar. We all know the prototypical American tourist who travels to exotic destinations and drinks Coca-Cola and eats McDonald's. The tourist returns with a collection of photographs and a few souvenirs, but they are largely unchanged by the experience. I believe that there's been a similar shift in the church. Sometime in the 20th century, we stopped calling Christians disciples and we started calling ourselves believers. Disciples are followers and imitators of Jesus, losing their lives in order to find it. The disciple is submerged or immersed or baptized in the language and the culture of Christ until his word and his world fundamentally reshape and redefine who we are, changing how the way we think, how we see, how we dream, and ultimately how we live. A believer regards and accepts as true the teachings and the beliefs of the Christian faith. But how deeply and how fervently those beliefs are held can vary from person to person. And sometimes belief can depend on circumstances or emotional states. Believers can get intensely defensive about their beliefs, but in their deep, honest moments, they may sometimes wonder why their beliefs have made so little difference to the way they live. You cannot be a disciple without being a believer, but it is very possible to be a believer without being a disciple. A believer can say all the right things, think all the right things, believe all the right things, do all the right things, and still not follow and imitate Jesus. The characteristic that distinguishes between a believer and a disciple of Christ is Holy Spirit-led transformation. As Paul exhorted us in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You may have picked up that I really like the Amplified Bible, sort of like a Bible and a commentary all combined into one. In the Amplified Bible, that second part of Romans chapter 2 says, be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually by the renewing of your mind on godly values and ethical attitudes. We find those godly and ethical attitudes in God's word, in the Bible. In his second letter, Peter wrote, his divine power has bestowed on us absolutely everything that is necessary for a dynamic spiritual life and godliness through true and personal knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. Regardless of where we are and what we have done, the knowledge of God and of his ways requires a decision from us. Will we be travelers in the kingdom, forever changed by our experiences on the journey? Or will we just be tourists, visiting out of curiosity and observing without commitment and involvement? Will we settle for being believers, accepting the teachings and belief of the Christian faith, but not really allowing them to alter the way that we live? Or will we be disciples of Jesus, following him, imitating him, immersed in his word, allowing the Holy Spirit to transform us from the inside out, changing the way that we think, that we act, and we live? Travelers or tourists? Believers or disciples? Maybe you have been a tourist in the kingdom, but you want to be a traveler. Perhaps you once were a disciple, but with the pressures and the stresses of life and living, you've become more like a believer. Today is the day to change direction. Now is the time to decide whether you will submit to the transforming power of the Holy Spirit. Please will you just listen to it, and if it resonates with you, make it a prayer. Just like he did. cannot change ourselves. That's just an outside transformation. We have to pray, Lord, change me from the inside. Can we just close quickly? Father, just thank you for your transforming power by your Holy Spirit. Lord, don't let us stay the same. Help us, Holy Spirit, to surrender the things that we've held on to so tightly. And Lord, transform us. Change us from the inside out. Lord, we know it's a struggle. We know that it's hard to let go of some of these things. But Father, we know that our purpose is to be changed from glory to glory as you are revealed more and more in us. Lord, help us to make a definitive choice to be either travelers or